Presentation. So today I will be speaking about expressive modeling of virtual worlds, combining knowledge and control. So for a change, I will be speaking of a step which is before fabrication, hoping that it works. The step of modeling. And first of all, what is expressive modeling? Expressive modeling is providing to the user seamless creation tool. And for that, you need to have to think graphical model in a user-centered perspective. For instance, you would like to provide the user with gesture-based control. Transfer, which is copy-paste, for instance, you take the dress on the woman model, you want to copy it to the children model. So this is copy-paste, this is a transfer gesture. Other gesture can be sculpting gesture. Other gesture can mean sketching gesture. And my point is that to make this expressive modeling possible, what you need to do is in fact to put knowledge in your model. So in these examples here on those slides, this knowledge is about developable surfaces. So in our work on developable surfaces, which are models also that can be fabricated because you have that 2D pattern that can be computed, so you can fabricate those models. So the use you provide this user this simple gesture, very intuitive, and anybody can use them, and then you come out with a 3D model. And in this talk, I'll change a little bit from fabrication. The goal here is this expressive modeling. Can it be extended to complex cases such as virtual worlds? Of course, virtual worlds cannot be fabricated. I'll go away from fabrication here. So the challenges in virtual worlds is that you have huge numbers of elements. You have multiple rules to maintain, and maybe this is a common point with fabrication. Fabrication, you have physical rules to maintain, but here the rule can come from geology, biology, statistics, dynamics for motion, mass preservation. So you have all these multiple rules to maintain, and yet the user would like to have control on the virtual worlds they are creating. You have also complex interaction between different elements that behave with different rules. For instance, here the waterfall interacts with the terrain, and they should be designed jointly. And you have ecosystems such as vegetation, which is interacting with the resources. So can we combine the consistency of these virtual worlds behaving according to all these rules with user control, giving user tools to the user such as painting, sculpting, and copy-pasting? We started working on this area in my group quite a few years ago, and many of you have already seen presentations of this work, so I will not go into this work. I'll change a little bit. So in the first work, just to give you an example, it was a multi-resolution sketch-based modeling method designed with biologists, where in fact you zoom progressively to sub-part of a tree, and you just sketch the outer contour of your tree part in 2D, and then we put knowledge at the same time on biology and on statistics, so that when you zoom out, you have a full tree that fulfill biological laws, and at the same time that correspond to your sketch. And this is done in 1 or 2 minutes. The second work here, the two other works, in some sense, they sculpt terrain based, for instance, of first person exploration of terrain. The person goes over the terrain and sketch silhouettes they want to see for mountain, and the terrain is automatically sculpted with minimal deformation in order to match the constraint given by the user. And in the work below, in the design waterfall scenes, the user is given very simple vector input like sketching to sketch the waterfall and the rivers and the basins they want to have. And the terrain automatically adapts to the user design, and at the same time, the system enforces flow control so that the waterfall scene is fully consistent. Fully consistent, but not necessarily really realistic, and we'll see at the end a much better method for sculpting terrain. So, what I will present in this talk are twofold. First, how can we design with expressive control consistent ecosystems? And secondly, how can you define with this expressive user control geologically consistent terrains? So these are more recent work. The first work I will present, EcoBrush, derives from a paper we had in 2005 called World Brush. So I will remind what World Brush is before describing Eco Brush. And then I'll present a work that was not published yet, but is in revision. And so this is an opportunity to present it. So the World Brush, in fact, is inspired from texturing method, a little bit like texturing method that Joël was presenting this morning. In fact, it's also a method with learning by example. So we often you learn texture from example. We do it in a different way here. We inspire from a painting metaphor to populate a virtual world with objects. The idea is that the user could not put all these stones on slope of the terrains, all these trees where it's more flat, all these blades of grass behind trees by hand. They need an automatic method. Then it would be very long to do it by hand, but what can provide the user is a small exemplar, like the one on the top, when he designed only maybe 8 trees and put a few stones on the slope. And then this will be used as an exemplar for learning statistical distribution of elements. So we use this here mostly point processes. In fact, we will correlate this distribution of stones, of trees, of blades of grass together, as well as with altitude, terrain slope, and other maps that can be defined on the terrain. And this exemplar is stored as one of the colors in these palettes. And then you can really inspire from a painting interface where the user will be using tools like a pipette tool to learn a new color, a brush to transfer. So it's really like the transfer of garment. You transfer, but the statistical distribution, it will not replicate exactly the same tree. But when you paint with a brush, it will give the same distribution. It will be consistent with the slope and so on. Gradient, move and deform, and so on. So how does it work? First, the learning and synthesis is done with point processes. So the basic idea is that from a given point, you will count in histograms the number of elements, for instance, of the same kind or of a different kind that you have in different disks around you. And we extended it to make it robust to very few numbers of elements, and also to enable to count it also histograms according to the angle, so that we can have an alignment of trees along roads, for instance, in our virtual worlds. But we also have histograms that describe the correlation with graphs and maps. So I gave the example of slopes, but you can have also, for instance, trees that go more likely near a river, for instance. So they learned their histogram distance to a river. Then we also extended this learning and synthesis method for distribution for distribution of graphs. So in this case, you have the same learning histogram for the node synthesis. And then we have the path synthesis uses a random walk, when in fact, when you are at a node, you look at your neighboring node, and you choose from the histogram of distribution of angles, you choose the more likely, and you go on. And also we prevent collisions between part of graph. So then adding other tools is quite easy. So for the copy-paste tool, you just reproduce the same color, but what is important, is the insight important here, is the use of an influence zone. So when you produce new content, you have to look also at the content already there around you, so that you have consistent groups of trees, for instance. We also extended seam carving deformation to virtual worlds. So you, if you want a larger, a little forest here, it will just find a path, cut it, and add content inside. And also we discovered that if we want to do blending gradient between colors, like the gradient here between a dense forest and little island with no trees, what we need to do is optimal mass transport between the histograms, and this corresponds exactly. It's quite fascinating to what the human perception we perceive has a gradient transition between the two colors. So this is a little demonstration of this work. So we have learned a color with a pipette tool. Now we can just copy paste it in a large terrain. We can also use it with a brush tool. And you see that the brush doesn't do the same thing at any place. It really correlates the little trees with the slope, and you can also move your little forest, and it adapts minimally to respect the statistics. Here an example of the gradient color. So here we are painting with using two different colors, the little islands and the forest, And we can even paint, if we like, with a gradient brush, which creates more denser forest at the middle and little island in the around. Here is the example of seam carving. So you deform your content. You see, it's really a seamless creation too. And we have some new content appearing. And here we do it with little villages. We will see better in the result. So this is a kind of scene we can create. So if we see it like this, we really have kind of toy example. Of course, we can have this little lake, this little houses aligned with the graphs representing the road. So it works pretty well. But what we did recently with a colleague from South Africa called James Gain is extending this wall brush method to a new thing, which is modeling consistent large ecosystem, also with user control. And here you have a few results of our approach. So in this case, you have huge terrains of several hundreds of kilometers. And it would be impossible to do an ecosystem simulation. I mean, an ecosystem simulation is when you simulate the growth of plant one by one, considering it's a physically based simulation, when you consider moisture, temperature, altitude, and so on, and they interact together for resources. It's too huge. But we had a good idea to be able to use this statistical modeling and extend it and have this echo brush that will be presented at next Geographics. So how does it work? First, what we do is that we do a multi-dimensional terrain clustering. This means that we regroup the part of the terrain that are exactly the same abiotic condition. Abiotic conditions are these conditions that don't consider the other plants, like temperature, altitude, and so on. Then we will do very small sandbox simulation for each of these clusters. After that, it's easy, we learn the statistic for the distribution we have found for each cluster in the little sandbox simulation. And then we just use the equivalent of wall brush. Now we can copy paste the same distribution that come from simulation everywhere in the terrain. And we can also use high level brushes. Let me detail how it works. So first, the input is only a very large terrain. And automatically, we can compute a number of maps. These maps include, so of course, we give an altitude and latitude to have the amount of rain and runoff, of course. So we have, from that, we compute the temperature, the sunlight map, the moisture map, and so on. So moisture, for instance, is computed from a simulation of erosion using runoff, for instance. Then, when we have all these maps representing the condition, we will use a k-means clustering to cluster, in fact, each part of the terrain into a small number of clusters, and usually 6 to 10 clusters are sufficient. When this is done, now we can use a sandbox simulation for each cluster. So for each sandbox simulation, we use a quite small terrain, typically 100 meters per 100 meters. And interestingly, plants are modeled as pairs of circles. So one of the circles is a canopy of the plant, and the other one is a root. And in fact, plants have two ways to interact. Either, like in the green cells here, their canopy intersect, they shadow each other, if you like, or in the brown part at the bottom, in the brown cells, it's the roots who are interacting. And then they compete for moisture, not for sunlight. Once, for the ecosystem simulation is quite classical, but the way it works is that each month you compute the vigor of the plant from the plant type, from the resources, and from the competition. And this has been done very carefully with a dictionary of possible plants, which depend on different ecosystems on Earth. And if a vigor is positive, then the plant will grow. If it's negative, it has a probability of death. And the mature plant will seed once a year. And then we have this little representation of the resulting ecosystem. So here we have used cones and spheres and boxes to represent the different kinds of trees. But we can, like this, compute our little ecosystems. Now, for learning the statistic, we have a big challenge. Is that now it's not point processes which exist, but it's disk processes. We have to compute the statistics between distributions of possibly overlapping disks. And of course, position and size of the disk are highly correlated. For instance, if we were just seeding point position for plant, and we wanted then to add the size of the canopy, it would not be necessarily easy, because we would have to do lots of iteration that would look like another simulation, because if points are too close, for instance, you would end up, for instance, with large plants and other in the shadow when you don't want this and so on. We could have solved it using 2D histogram, but it would be extremely costly. So in fact, our solution, which is at least original, I don't know if it's good, but it works in our case, was to measure distance between disks. So they are symbolized by this little, so when you have the two disks at the left, you have a little scale between them, so these are the bins for the distance between the disks. But we add three other bins, which are plants that are shading each other, but less than half of the shading, but more than half when the position of the trunk of one of the plant is inside the disk of the other, and fully shaded when a disk within the other. And like this, we still have a single dimension for the histogram, and we measure the histogram exactly as in a wall brush. So now we want to have also interactive editing. So for that, we will use 17 brushes. How do we combine this user control with the fact to keep the consistency? So the idea is that these semantic brushes will model the local action of humans, of animals, and of fire that were of course not there in our model, so that it will still be realistic. In fact, when you, for instance, when you have fire, it's like if you put to zero the age of all your plants in a given region. We can also update the density. For the density, what we did is that we made sandbox simulations for much more than the few six clusters. And so we could also look for a denser configuration with other plants in the same abiotic condition. So this is what does the density brush. It will add these plants. And if it adds plants that cannot survive, after a while, these plants will die again. Then we can also be replanting other species like a human would do. These examples, these are our results at the bottom. So you see the abiotic condition as the African savanna. And you have the position of the camera on the map at the left. And in fact, the African savanna is in a region where there is a lot of rain. And if there was not the action of fire and big animals such as elephants, eating plants, and also men cutting trees and making fire, then it would be very dense. And so we had to, in fact, to edit by hand and add these other conditions to have something that looks like the savannah now. So let me show some results on this. So here you see all the maps that are successively computed for a given terrain. So this is an example of a Mediterranean terrain. With a small mountain near the sea. Here you have all the different ecosystem, sandbox ecosystem simulation by varying condition. So you see that we compute much more to offer brushes to the user. We can compute much more than we sample, in fact, or the different cluster we have. Oh, what I didn't say is that we also have this gradient tool. So in fact, we generate also ecosystems that are intermediate between. And here we are. What do these brushes here is augmenting the age and augmenting the density of the plant successively. And this is a kind of large terrain that are generating with our approach. So you see that. This work that seemed like a toy, the wall brush, now seemed like something useful to create large virtual worlds for simulators and things like that, that you can then explore and be surprised when you move into these virtual worlds. So here you have the African savanna now. And I think the last example is an alpine region. It looks more like the Rocky because there is no action of the human. If you go in the French Alps, you don't find like wild places like this one. The last work I wanted to present to you is the idea of sculpting. We discussed sculpting a little bit, really sculpting with hand. My inspiration is a virtual clay model you see on the left, an old work we did with Paul Cry, which is really where you have this real-time virtual clay and you want to edit it really with your hand. But in fact, the crust of the earth is really a real material, so why not try to sculpt it with our hands? And what is quite good is that, in fact, it's almost 2D. So 2D interaction on a touch table can be sufficient to sculpt it. And this was the idea for sculpting mountain. So here, it's a collaboration with a geologist. We are trying to find the right physically based model that should be real time for this earth crust, and sculpting with hand by reusing all the sculpting metaphor we have used for very long time in my group for virtual clay. And in fact, what we do, the user gesture, is define and move tectonic plates, because you may know that mountain ranges grow when you have collisions between the tectonic plates. So what you see at the bottom is a kind of feed after several user gesture, several tectonic plates with different motions have been defined, and the mountains will grow when these tectonic plates collide. So how does it work? Maybe let me explain a little bit the figure at the top. So at the top you see the knowledge we extracted from the colleague in geology called Jean Brown. So what happens is that you have two tectonic plates colliding. So you have subduction of the one which comes from the left, which in fact is like kind of split into parts, because most of the plates is going down the other one, but there is a little crust at the bottom which is raised upon above the other one. The other one doesn't move much, it stays here, and so one of the plates goes for this subduction. And what happened is that these tectonic plates, they are not made on a single layer of rock, they are made of multiple layers of rock with different thicknesses, with quite thinner and also maybe more rigid layers of rock at the top. And it has been shown that these layers of rock, they fold with different thicknesses. Exactly like the mechanical models we study in computer graphics, there was a very interesting SIGGRAPH paper, for instance, showing exactly what are these wavelengths, recently also a paper by Paul Cry, what are these wavelengths depending on the different thicknesses when you have a layered model. So it's exactly the same phenomenon here. So what we have for the sub-phenomenon that we want to simulate is that you have a constant volume, because most of the earth crust is really this plasticine-like material that deforms at constant volume, which means that when it is compressed, it will increase in thickness, which is quite simple. And then on top, you have these little folds with different wavelengths that you have to simulate. And we use the layered model to decouple these phenomena and also simulate them in a consistent way. So the user input gestures, and first we have a layer that will simulate crust like plastic material. It's really inspired from my previous virtual clay models, but in 2D. This means that when you compress, it's like a viscous fluid, when you compress, it will just increase in thickness. Then we add this layer sheet model, and to implement them in real time, we did it in a geometrical way, just using the different wavelength. Here, really the insight is, if you know already what is going to do a physically based simulation, why should we, each time step, recompute this physically based simulation? Then it's just much better just to use the geometric output that you know that will be there. It's phenomenological modeling, in fact. So we add this folding of the layered sheets, and then at runtime we have the uplift U is in fact the what we compute is a speed of uplift of coming up of these different layers of soil. And at runtime, we simulate the uplift with the erosion, with the fluvial erosion. This was a paper last year at Eurographics, our new model for erosion, fluvial erosion in real time. And we worked also on validation on this method. So you have a cut here of our model, so you understand better that we are using these different layers of material that fold with these different wavelengths, and we have erosion that comes and erodes the material on the top. So what is very interesting with that is that when we have some parts of the terrain that appear, we know perfectly from which part of the rock crust they come, and we can render them with different color. So for the first time in computer graphics, we can generate terrain where you see these very nice layers of rocks on eroded cliffs, which is not in terrain but databases. So you cannot do it for, we don't have this for the real terrains, but we can do it with our model. So for validation, on the left, you see comparison with real terrain data. So you have the main Alpine mountain in New Zealand on the top, and the fact that there, it's completely dissymmetric, you have this main fault that we have also on the cut. So in fact, this means that on one side of a mountain range, you don't have faults, it's just like kind of flat, and then all the little faults come the other side. And the comparison with the Rocky, in fact, really compares the zone when you have this multi-scale folding result. And just to show you a little demo here, and also some nice renderings. So here you see the position of the user fingers. So the user is interacting in real time, and he see in real time at least a lower resolution version of the layer model. The layer model is fully computed, but for display, we display a slightly lower resolution version. So I didn't put the full video. Okay, so in conclusion, so this talk has shown that expressive modeling paradigms can be extended to complex cases. So really the methodology is to give control to the user, interactive control, so we need real-time models, and all the constraints we give them to the systems thanks to models that embed knowledge. And this nicely extends to complex rules and to distributions of elements. For virtual worlds, what remains to be done? You could think, okay, they are already very nice and very realistic, but in fact, they are just empty. And it would be very nice to have also distributions of animated distributions of animals walking and also flying over this virtual world, and also competing for resources, interacting with all that. Also, there is interaction about between the vegetation and the erosion that was not modeled yet. So there are still, and glacier erosion, so there are still venues for the work. But maybe in a longer term, what I see for the future of this work on expressive modeling would be really to be extend these ideas to more general modeling systems. You have seen here, I have been working with scientists from other disciplines, biology, geology, to incorporate, to understand the knowledge they have and incorporate this in models. But recently, I also spoke with a physicist studying membranes in liquids, to biologists studying the deformation and changes of shape of blood platelets. And in fact, what would be really interesting is to provide to those scientists an expressive modeling system where they could start with very simple low end interaction. And each time they sketch things or they do a gesture, their little model starts doing something and they could add a hypothesis on the fly. And I think it would be very nice to try to think of what are the common points between all the models we are using and how this layered model can incorporate little by little more constraints. But the difference maybe with the work we have been presenting is that here I have the user in the loop. So I don't need so much optimization because the user is there and seeing what the result of their editing gesture, they can themselves optimize that gesture to get the result they want in a sense. Thank you very much.